أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعد فرج أجمعين Dear brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum. Today our topic is the event of Mubahila. As you know that this month is unique in a sense that we have got three Eids in this month. Eid al-Adha, Eid al-Ghadir and Eid al-Mubahila. Being a Shia, we are unique in a sense that we have two extra Eid, that is Eid al-Ghadir and Eid al-Mubahila. Why do we have two extra Eid? And why do we have two extra celebrations? The answer is very simple, that we have extra grief, we have extra sadness. And you will know when we will be passing through Ayyam-e Azam that are soon to come. So when the people put question in front of you, why you people, Shia or Mazhab followers of the Mazhab Ahlul Bayt, you cry more and lament and do matam in Ayyam-e Azam? So why you are so sad during the martyrdom of Imam Hussain? You can say that we have extra grief, that is why we have extra celebrations, or vice versa, we have extra celebrations, that is why we have extra grief. So this is what we say, Adli Ilahi. If Allah has given some grief, He will give some extra pleasure. So if Allah has given us tendency or opportunity to cry over the martyrdoms of our Imam and Masumeen, Allah has given us extra pleasure in the form of two extra Eid. So this is what we call Adli Ilahi. Before we begin the main topic, the core topic of Mubahila, let us begin with some terminologies which are similar to Mubahila so that we can avoid any confusion which can come to our mind during the discussion of Mubahila. There are four terminologies which are similar to Mubahila. So let us discuss briefly what are these terminologies. For example, the first one is Muzakirah. Second is Mubahisa. The third is Munazira. And the fourth is Mujadila. The first two usually you come across when you are watching and having an experience of media. That is Muzakirah and Mubahisa. Muzakirah is what two parties sit together. Two people sit together and they discuss and they try to solve some issue. For example, a delegation from Pakistan, a delegation from India, they come together and sit in one place to discuss the issue of Kashmir. This is what we call Muzakirah. What is Mubahisa? When the two people sit together and give their own point of view. They do not want to convince each other, they do not want to solve some issue, just to give their point of views. It is up to you how to sort out who is right and who is wrong. This is what we see in our talk shows. So these talk shows are actually Mubahisa. Then come Munazira. What is Munazira? When the two parties sit together and they try to convince each other with the ideology, with the opinion they already have. For example, I talk to you and I ask you to be with me and you should accept my opinion, you should accept my ideology. And you talk to me, you request me to accept your ideology because you think you are right. This is what we call Munazira, like the Munazira between the Sunni and the Shia people. Then comes Mubahila. What is Mubahila? Mubahila is Mujadila. Mujadila is one step ahead of Munazira. That is when the two parties sit together and they try to convince each other and they do not come to one common point. So what they say that let's fight. Whoever win will be on the right side. So war in the time of Rasulullah, war in the time of Amir al-Mu'mineen, for example, Genghis Siffin, war of Siffin, it is example of Mujadila. So the two parties fight together and the party who wins, we say that he is on the right side. Although it is not that much according to Adal, but this is one way to discuss the main point. Now, let us come to Mujadila, Mubahila. Mubahila is what when the two parties sit together and they discuss the issue and after that they asked the God to intervene, to bring the chastisement or the wrath of Allah to the person, to the party who is on the wrong side, or to the liars. This is what we call Mubahila. So Mubahila and Mujadila, you can say the fate or the destiny is the same, that you want to perish your opponent, you want to see him killed, you want to see him under some hardship, but you want it to be brought upon by God. That is Mubahila. And if you do it if you do it by yourself, this is what we call Mujadila. So these are the few terminologies, Muzakira, Mubahisa, Munazira and Mujadila. Now the Mubahila. If you go into the meaning of Mubahila in the dictionary, you will find that Mubahila comes from the word Bhal. Bhal means to make anything free. Any person or anyone or anything free. Bahil is the word we use to the animal which is set free so that she can feed her babies. And Ibtihal is the word which we use to leave anybody on his own way or disposal. You must have read a sign usually on the car parking, that car parking on car's owner's risk. That is your own risk if you want to park the car. So this usually happens when the parents have a discussion with their children, and when they do not come to the point, the parents become angry and they say, go to hell, go out of this house, or do what you want to do and do not come to me, do not discuss this issue anymore. I do not have any relation with you, at least for this action I am not responsible. So this is what we call Ibtihal. And then this word was used in a negative sense for those also who are not obedient to Allah. So we say that Allah will take care of them by himself. This is what we call Ibtihal. Mubahila is, as I told you, is sitting discussion of a party in such a way that they will just pray. This is their discussion. They will pray to God that bring your chastisement to the liar, the person who is on the right side, on the wrong side. Okay. So what are the events which brought about the main event of Mubahila? Because there are chains of events which led to the event, main event of the Mubahila. So let's discuss this, and before that, recite a salawat. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad wa ali faraj majma'in. Second phase of our speech or debate is the messages and the event of Mubahila. Actually, when Rasulullah and his companions, when they were living in Mecca, they were facing hardships. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked them to migrate to Medina when the hardships cross their limits. So they migrated to Medina, and there they had a very warm welcome from Ansar of Medina, and they established Islamic government, and soon they took the hold of the area, not only of Medina but also the area around Medina, especially Makkah. The conquest of Makkah took place in 8th of Hijrah. On 9th of Hijrah, Rasulullah decided to invite others who are outside Medina and Makkah, outside Arab, to embrace Islam, to invite them to accept Islam as their religion. This is what we call, should be the strategy of Amr bin Ma'ruf wa Nahy bin Munkar, that when you are perfect by yourself, and when you are perfect among your community, you should start talking about your religions to the whole world. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa. So we are not the Khalifa of Mecca or Medina or some special place. We are the Khalifa of the whole world. So being a Muslim, we should teach and preach our religion to whole world, all the people, all the communities of the world. So Rasulullah started writing letters to different heads of the states and different heads of the tribes. And every letter almost, he wrote down a very beautiful selective ayah from the Quran, that is Surah Ali Imran, verse number 64. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this, قُلْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْ إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةٍ سَوَاءٍ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ أَلَّا نَعْبُدَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Say to Ahlul Bayt, come to the common point. What is that common point? Allah na'buda illallah, that we will not worship except Allah. And this is a good message for us that if we are sitting with the people who are not of our ideology, not of our religion, we should not talk about something which is controversial. People who are living in the Western areas, in Europe, in America, in Canada, this is a good example for them. If you are living with atheists, you should talk about humanity. If you are living with Christians, you should talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Prophet Isa. If you are living with Jews, you talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Prophet Musa. So this is the tactic, this is the technique and strategy we should adopt when we are going to do Amar bil Ma'ruf wa Nahi bil Munkar. So this is the same strategy Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam adopted. So he wrote the letter to different countries, to different heads, to different people and tribesmen. One of the letter went to the Christians of Najran, that is located somewhere near Yemen. But at that time, the Najran was the hub, the headquarters of Christianity, like it is now the Vatican City, which is the hub of the Christianity. At that time it was Najran. Most of the scholars of the Christians were living in Najran. So they were very much disturbed. And they felt the letter of Rasulullah is like an insult. Somebody has insulted their religion. Somebody has challenged them that your religion is wrong, leave it and quit this religion and come to us. So that is why they call all the people to come in the church, and they had a huge discussion. That is what we call manazira. This is what we discuss. Manazira is you are discussing the faith, you are discussing the ideology, and you are bent upon that the person whom you are talking to should accept your ideology. Now at this point you must be thinking that there were Christians only. Why they have munazira? Munazira takes place usually between the two peoples, two different types of people having different ideology. Actually there was a person named Abu Haritha. I am describing in detail about the manazira or the facts or the events which led to the main event of Maidan. There was a scholar called Abu Haritha. He was around 120 years old and he was a great scholar, and not a only a great scholar, but he was a great personality in a sense that he was a pious person, and he was going through the Bible and other books with heart, and he was not greedy, he was not running after the world. So he took no time to understand the prophet which who is mentioned in our book of Bible and other books is the same who is now present in Medina, and he is the same person, same prophet who has written the letter. So Abu Haritha was there and other Christian scholars were there. Among the most prominent were Sayyid, who was the head, that is you can call marji in our terminology, Sayyid, and the other one was Aqib. So Aqib and Sayyid, they were talking in support of Christianity, and they were asking the people to come and join hands and be united to fight with those who have challenged your religion, who has challenged their religion, Muslims. And they were proud of their power because they have connection with the king of Rome. So that's why they were very much satisfied that if they fight with the Muslims, sure, the king of Rome will come to help them, because king of Rome was in a good relationship with them. Why? It is the policy, or you can say strategy, of the kings of all time. They always keep a religious figure with them so that they can emotionally exploit common people. So that's what they were doing by using religion as their tool. They keep the people or the common person with them to support them. So these scholars, that is for example Sayyid and Aqib and other Christian scholars, they were taking huge amount of funds, huge amount of wealth, robes and invitation and gifts. So their status was, you can say, just next to the king. So they had everything, every luxury of life, without doing anything. Just they were the scholars. So they did not want to lose all these privileges given by the king at that time to them. So of course they were against Muslim, they were against Prophet Muhammad. But Abu Haritha, as I told you, was a nice person, and he was living his life in Taqiyya. This is what we say. Taqiyya means to hide your faith. If you are feeling insecurity in a place which is against Islam. So Abu Harisa was feeling insecurity among the people who were Christian, but Abu Harisa had already accepted Islam. So that is why he did not disclose his faith. But when he saw peoples of Christian community, they were adamant, they were ready to fight with the Muslims. He said that this is the time I should disclose my identity. I should let them know that who am I by faith. So he said that, oh, the people of Najran, oh, the Christian scholars, you should take your wisdom into account. You should think about the situation wisely. Do not be hurry. Do not stimulate and exploit the people. Do not ask them for the war. Let's think about it. What is this letter about and who is this personality? Then Abu Harisa said that this is the same person. He is the same prophet who is mentioned in our book of Bible. Chapter 4, Kitabul Misbah, Book of Misbah. So the Christian scholars, he was the only one who was supporting Islam, who was supporting Muslims and Prophet Muhammad. And all of them were against Abu Harisa, the only one. لِكُلِّ فِرْعَان مُوسَى. So Hatib and Aqib and Sayyid and other Christian scholars, they were very much confused and bewildered and very angry, furious over Abu Harisa, that he is the person who is going to disclose all our conspiracy, and he is going to disclose our real identity. He is going to explore what we are hiding actually. So what did they do? They just turned the topic and they said that you don't know Abu Harisa, you are a scholar, we know and we respect you as a knowledgeable person, but please mind it well that this person is Muhammad and we are talking about Ahmed. See, so beautifully they turned the topic and they try to divert their attention to another focus. They say that actually the prophecy, the news about Muhammad was given by Prophet Musa. And the prophecy, the news about Ahmad was given by Isa. He is Muhammad and we are talking about Ahmad and we are waiting for Ahmad. He said, what is the difference between Muhammad and Ahmad? And these are the two names of the two people, that why don't you accept Muhammad as prophet? He said that actually Muhammad is a prophet for his nation only. Muhammad is a prophet for the Quraysh, for the people of Medina and Mecca. And it was actually, it's a fact that it was the rule sometimes that at a time you have different prophets in the world, and each prophet is responsible for his territory, for his country, for his nation. So this was the logic given by Aqib and Sayyid, that Muhammad is only for the Quraishi people or for the Medina people or the people living in Mecca. We are different. He is not the prophet for the whole world. He was angry, Abu Harisa, that why they are turning the topic, why they are giving lame excuses, and why they are hiding the facts. So he gave a very beautiful logic from Book of Zajira. You know, actually, we have books other than Quran. If you do not understand anything from Quran, and if it is not clear, something is not clearly mentioned, so we go to our book like Kafi, like Istabsar, Mallai, Azurub al-Faqir, like Biharul Anwar, Masail al-Shia, Mafati, and other books we go. And we see what is the real interpretation of the ayah and what is the solution of our problem. So he brought the book of Zajira, in which it was mentioned that a prophet will come whose name will be Farqalid. He said, okay, forget Muhammad, forget Ahmad, just focus on Farqalid. Don't you think the features which are mentioned in the book of Zajira about Farqalid, the prophet, these features are present in the present prophet, that is Muhammad? So don't accept Muhammad or Ahmad, don't go into the discussion of the name, just focus on Farqalid. What about Farqalid? Then these two Christian scholars, Aqib and Sayyid, they ask Abu Harisa, who Farqalid you are talking about? They were pretending that they do not know exactly who is Farqalid. So Abu Harisa mentioned that Farqalid is whose son will rule the whole world. Actually, he wanted to point out towards Imam Mahdi. the son of Khalid, that is the son of Muhammad, will rule the world, that is Imam Mahdi. And that is mentioned in the Sa'ifa Mashamun. Shamun, who is the successor of Prophet Isa. So at that point, they were very much confused and they were very much embarrassed that now maybe our conspiracy is going to be disclosed. They say that you are on the wrong side still. If he is Far Khalid, they brought another logic, another point. If he is Far Khalid, then where is his son? You said that his son will rule the world. Muhammad, Prophet Muhammad does not have any son, so he is not the Far Khalid. This is another situation, another logic they brought. Then Abu Harisa went to his peak and he brought many books to show them the proof. First of all, he brought the book of Kitabul Jami'a. Just like our Kafi, there was Kitabul Jami'a. The name suggests it was a big book, authentic book. In Kitabul Jami'a, he showed them that it is mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once showed a nur to Prophet Adam. When Adam alayhi salam asked, what is this nur? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this nur is of Ahmad. As I am Mahmud, so he is Muhammad. See, now the problem, the issue of the two names of the two different personalities are solved. It means these two names belong to one person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduced his prophet. How? This nur is of Ahmad. As I am Mahmud, so he is Muhammad. So the Ahmad and Muhammad are the two names of the same person. Then he said, the nur which is standing behind him is the nur of his wasi, Imam Ali. Then the nur standing behind him is the nur of his daughter, Bibi Sayyida. Then the two nurs were standing behind Bibi Sayyida. These are the two sons of Prophet. And the other nurs are the sons of Prophet. And the last one is the nur just like the star of the body. This is the nur who will be ruling the world. So in this way he proved, Abu Harisa proved, that Ahmad and Muhammad are the two names of the same person. And then he brought another book, that is, it is not a book actually, pages, we call it Sahifa. Sahifa Ibrahim, Sahifa Shis, and some other books he brought. So Kitab al-Jamia, Kitab al-Zajira, Sahifa Ibrahim, Sahifa Shampun, and Sahifa Shis. So two books and three Sahif. The five one were there to counter their problems, to counter their logics. So all the Christian scholars, they were totally in bewilderment, totally confused, especially these two scholars who were defending Christianity in a wrong way. That is Sayyid and Aqib, they were very much, you can say, embarrassed, and they were thinking what to do. So, as I told you before, they knew it very well that he is the same person, he is the same prophet who is mentioned in their book. But because of the greed of the world, greed of the wealth, greed of the gift, parties and status, they did not want to accept Prophet as their Prophet Muhammad as their prophet, because all these luxuries and privileges will go to Prophet Muhammad and they will be subordinate under the supervision of Prophet Muhammad. That is why. So what did they decide now? To delay the issue, what we call it, delaying tactics. So they said that, okay, whatever you said, we accept, all these things are true and your logic is okay, acceptable, but we want to see this person by our eyes. We want to discuss something with this person face to face. Then we will decide that who is on the wrong side, and if he is the real prophet, we will accept. So now they set off from their place, from Najran. 1400 people were there in their possession, and they reached Medina. When they reached Medina, they were wearing very beautiful clothes made up of silk. They were wearing gold jewelry with the gold rings, and they were coming just like the kings. So they were giving a corner in the mosque of Nabawi, and they were doing their prayer the way they wanted. And as you know that we have Azan and Aqab for our prayer, so they have Naqus, that is a special church bell. They ring it so that the people get ready for their prayer. But when they were ringing it, companions of Rasulullah, they got angry. What is this? In the Mosque of Nabawi, they are ringing the bell of Christian church. Rasulullah said them, don't disturb them, let them do whatever they want to do. They are our guests, and we are Muslims, we are doing our ibadah, our worship. So let them see what we are doing, how we are praying, how we are carrying out our daily routines. And that's a beautiful logic. If you tell them, who, the Christian scholars, to go away somewhere, so they would not be able to see the routine of Muslims. They would not be able to see and meet and to have interaction with the Muslims. So this is another point of Amr bin Ma'ruf and Nahy bin Munkar. So people who are living in the Western culture, Western society, Western countries, they are sometimes confused what to do. Should we live here or should we leave to our country? So the answer is this, that if you are confident that you can save your iman among the society of Western countries, and you can convince others with your character, with your logic, you should stay there. It is wajib for you. If you can save people who are living in the Western countries by saving their faith, by giving them information, if you can save, not only you can secure your iman, but also can protect iman of your colleagues, iman of your mu'min brother, you should stay there. So that is why it is not bad to have interaction with the Christians, with the Jews, with the atheists. No problem if you are quite strong in your faith, in your actions. Inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will let them come to you, will convince them with your actions. But the condition is your actions should be pure, your intention should be pure, and you should be a practical person. You should prove by yourself that I am a true Muslim. Anyway, they were doing the prayer, they were doing the worship, but in these 3 days, Rasulullah did not pay any attention, even he did not give the answer to their salam. Why? They went to Abdurrahman bin Auf, Osman bin Affan, and they asked them, what is this? We have come from so far place, Najran, and we want to talk to your Prophet, and your Prophet is quite indifferent to us, not giving any time, not looking at us, not giving answer to our questions. What is this? So they said that we do not know exactly what's going on and what is in his heart. Let's go to Imam Ali. Let's go to Ali and ask him that what is the reason behind it. So they went to Ali. Ali, without consulting Prophet Muhammad, directly said to them, the way you came, it is not permitted. It is not allowed. You are allowed to stay just for the reason because you have come to talk to Prophet Muhammad. But Rasulullah does not like people wearing jewelry of gold and the dresses of silk. You should come with the normal dress as we are wearing. So they went back. This is again a logic, a message for us that we should not respect any person who is wearing good clothes, having a good model of latest mobile or latest car, have a huge house. So usually we become impressed with the appearance of the people, with the dress of the people, with the property, with the wealth, with the status they possess in the society. No way. This is not the method, the strategy or the sunnah of Rasul. Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. The person who is muttaqi, pious, he is having high status in front of Allah, in front of Rasul. So please do not look down upon the people who are poor just because they are not wearing good dress, they are not having enough amount of money, they are not living in a big house, they do not have the car or whatever. So respect the people because of their knowledge, respect the people because of their taqwa. Ilm and amal, these are the two things you should focus on. Anyway, so when they came back with the normal dress, they start talking munazira. This is what we said. Munazira is what? You have your own way, me have my own way of ideology. And we are talking to each other to convince each other. So a Christian sitting in front of Rasulullah, and now they are talking to each other about their religions and trying to convince. So the first question, actually they had planned already, who? Aqib and Sayyid and other Christian scholars who were supporting them, that we should discuss the issue which is controversial, and no way our community will be agreed about it. This is quite contradictory to the strategy of Rasulullah. Rasulullah said, "Ta'alu ila sawain bainana wa bainakum." Come towards the common point which is common to both of us. And they were talking about something which is not common to both. So intentionally they opened the topic of Jesus. They opened the topic of divine relationship of Jesus. They asked Rasulullah, what do you think about Prophet Isa? Rasulullah said in a plain way that he was a prophet. He was a common man. He was talking, eating, sleeping and moving here and there just like a common person. And deliberately he said this. He did not stop after saying just he was a prophet. No, he continued. He said he was a prophet and he was a common man. When he said common man, they became angry. And this is the point, they wanted to exploit the emotions of their community. That they know, they knew it very well, that their community in no circumstances are going to believe that Prophet Isa is a common person. He is a prophet, okay, but if he is a common man, no way. Because they think Prophet Isa is the son of God, so he must be the God also. So they said to Rasulullah, sarcastically, have you ever seen a child, a person without father? Instead of Rasulullah, this time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the answer, the final answer of the manazir. What was the answer? Surah Al Imran, chapter 3, verse number 59. Inna Isa masala indallahi kamasali Adam. In the sight of Allah, example or likeness of Isa is just like the likeness or the example of Prophet Adam. How? Khalaqahu min turabin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam from turab, from the sand. ثم قال كن فيكون. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, be, and he was. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need a mechanism, he does not need a process, he does not need a wasila or any medium or any tool or any special circumstances or situation to create, to bring something in reality. So he said to Turab, be, and it was. That means he said to Turab, change into Prophet Adam, and the Turab changed into Prophet Adam. This is the simple way of Allah to create. When he created this world, he said kun, and fayakun, the world was there. So the logic is, if you say that a child cannot be born without father, then what about then what about from Prophet Adam? He was born without father as well as without mother. So if the creation of Isa is not possible without father, then how the creation of Prophet Adam was possible without father, without mother? At this point they were shut up. They were silent, totally silent. And they did not have any logic, any answer, and any explanation in their pocket. So they said, one of them, why don't we do Mubahila? Immediately the ayah of Mubahila, Surah Al Imran, verse number 61, just two ayah after this verse about Isa, ayah Mubahila came. And what was in the ayah Mubahila? Faman hajjaka fihi. If they fight, if they have dispute over what? مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ. If they have dispute over the knowledge which has come to you, then what we should do, if somebody is fighting with me and the fact is quite clear, open, what we should do? فَقُلْ تَعَالُوا نَدْعُ. Tell them, call, ask them to come and call. Whom we should call? An army? No, if we call the army, it will be Mujadila. We are not going to do Mujadila. This time we are going to Mubaila. In Mubaila, whom you should call? Ta'alu nad'u abna'ana abna'akum. I will call, we will call our son, you will call your son. Nisa'ana nisa'akum. We will call our ladies, you will call your ladies. Wa anfusana wa anfusakum. We will call our nafs, you will call your nafs. That much we should do. Discussion? No. The time is over. We should not do discussion this time. This time is the final decision from Allah. What we should do? ثُمَّ نَبْتَهِلْ فَنَجْعَ اللَّهَ نَتَ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ. Then we will do مُبَاهِلَا. ثُمَّ نَبْتَهِلْ. نَبْتَهِلْ from ابْتِهَالِ. ثُمَّ نَبْتَهِلْ. We will do مُبَاهِلَا. How the مُبَاهِلَا is done? Is carried out? فَنَجْعَ اللَّعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ. That curse upon the liars. Curse of Allah upon the liars. That is, Allah will bring His chastisement over the liars or over the party who is on the wrong side. When this verse was revealed, they did not have any option. They did not have any avenue or door open to go and to escape. They had to do it. Even then, they asked Rasul, would you give us some time to discuss the issue and then we'll come to you? This is the fact. This shows that they were not on the right side. If they were on the right side, they must have accepted it from the beginning. So they went back and they discussed with each other what to do. One of them said, if Prophet Muhammad will come with an army, he is not Prophet. If Prophet Muhammad will come with his family members, he is the Prophet. Look, even they have a ray of hope that Muhammad will be on the wrong side. Astaghfirullah. Again, there is a message in this. That if you are on the right side, 5 people will be enough to defeat 1400 people. Few people will be enough to fight with the enormous army, huge army. We have seen in Badr, 313 versus 1000. So here, the 5 were the purest 5. The 5 were the best in the world. Ahlul Bayt, Panjatan. So they say that if he comes with the family, he is on the right side. If he comes with the army, he will be on the wrong side. Now the day of Mubahila reached, that is 24th of Zilhajj. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with his family, having Imam Hussein in his lap, while Imam Hassan was holding his finger. At the back was Bibi Sayyida, and at the back of Bibi Sayyida was Imam Ali. Exactly the same sequence they followed as mentioned in Ayah Mubahila. Abna'ana abna'akum. Your children, your sons, that is Hasan and Hussain. Wa nisa'ana wa nisa'akum. That is your lady, that is Fatima. Anfusana wa anfusakum. That is your nafs, that is Imam Ali. Exactly the same. See how the Ahlul Bayt follow Quran exactly step by step. So when Rasulullah brought them, he sit under the tree and he stretched upon them a black sheet, and he recited the verse of Surah Ahzab, chapter 33, verse 33. إِنَّمَا يُرِدُ اللَّهُ لِيَذْهَبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. For sure, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to keep away, to repel Nijasa, uncleanness from Ahlul Bayt, and purify you as thoroughly purified. At this point, I want to divert your attention over this issue that we should translate this verse as to keep away uncleanness, to keep away Nijasa, or to repel Nijasa, to repel uncleanness. Do not say to remove the Nijasa. When we say remove the Nijasa, it means Nijasa was there and now you are removing. Astaghfirullah. And Nijasa here means sin. Nijasa here means mistake. Nijasa means you disobey your God. Astaghfirullah. Ahlul Bayt never did it. So how you will remove the nijasa? Was there any nijasa or sin committed by Rubat? No. So we should translate it as keep the nijasa away or the repel nijasa from the Ahlul Bayt and purify them as thoroughly purified, as there is a haq or right of purification. When Rasulullah recited this verse, he asked his Ahlul Bayt that I will pray and you will say Ameen. When Rasulullah raised his hands, there were some changes brought upon within the environment. What were the changes? The color of the sun became changed. There were black, huge, enormous clouds. Actually, it was not the season of rain, but there were black clouds. Mountains in the field of Mubahila were trembling. Trees were bent down. Birds with their wings spread, bowed down. When this situation occurred, one of the person from the Christians, his name was Manar bin Al-Qaba. He went to the Christian scholars and asked them, what you are doing? Don't you see such faces? Who, if request God to move the mountain from its place, the mountain, the greatest mountain will move from its place. And don't you see the signs of chastisement of Allah? Athar Adabi Ilahi, don't you see the signs? And these are the same signs which were present at the time of Yunus al-Islam upon the nation of Yunus. And his nation did the repentance, asked forgiveness from Allah and Allah forgave them. So please ask forgiveness from Allah and do compromise sulah with this prophet, otherwise you will be in jeopardy. And none of the Christians will be alive on the face of the earth. Within 1 year, the whole Christianity will be perished from the whole world. When they saw the environment and when they look meticulously upon the faces of the Ahlul Bayt, so they came to know that we have done a great mistake. And if we continue, Mubahila, sure disaster will come to us and we will be perished and we will be removed from the face of the earth. So they asked Manar bin Al-Qama, please go to Rasul and ask him to do the sulah and we are ready to pay jizya. See, they realized Prophet was right. He is the real Prophet. His Ahlul Bayt are the greatest personality. Everything was okay. They were on the right side. Prophet was on the right side. Islam is the true religion. The truthfulness of Islam was totally exposed. Even then, they did not embarrass Islam. Even then, they did not convert to Islam. They were ready to pay tax. They were ready to pay jizya or tax. That is a special tax given to the Islamic government by the people who are not Muslims. So this is a message for us that we are ready to give charity. We are giving ready to give homes. We are ready to give sadaqa. When it comes the time of namaz, we say, no, I cannot pray. Is there any way I will give the money and to get rid of namaz? People are asking such absurd questions that I don't want to keep fast in Ramadan. Is there any way? How many dollars, how much money I have to pay for one fast? What is this? If you do not have a valid reason, you cannot escape your fast. So this is what the people are doing. Not all, some of us, they are doing it. They are wealthy, they have enough money to spend. So they think that we can buy the paradise with our money. No, you have to buy the paradise from your hasanat, from your good deeds. This was the mistake committed by Christians, that they wanted to buy the paradise with their money, but they did not want to accept Islam. So please, my dear brother and sister, do not do this mistake. Do not think ever that you can buy Islam, you can buy paradise with your money. You have to be Muslim and you have to convert to be Muslim as a whole 100%, not partially. Anyway, so they said, Manar bin Al-Qama, please go and talk to Rasulullah. We are ready to give tax or jizya. Anyway, when they came to Rasulullah, asked, I need to go as my nafs, as my substitute, as my successor, and talk to them. Ali asked Rasulullah, on what basis, on what conditions I should do the compromise or sulah with them? Rasulullah said, whatever you want, it's up to you. Your actions and your words are my actions and my words. See, this is the proof that Ali was the true nafs of Rasul. That is why Rasulullah said, I don't care whatever you do, because I am sure whatever you will do, it will be exactly according to Islam, according to my will and the will of God. So Imam Ali went there and he talked to them, and they were agreed upon giving 2,000 robes, beautiful clothes, 1,000 in Rajab, 1,000 in Muharram, 30 spears, 30 horses, and 30 armors, which the soldiers wear made up of iron when they go in the battlefield. So these 30 armors, spears, and horses they had to give whenever there is a war, and Muslims needed it to fight their enemy. So they were agreed to pay tax, to pay jizya, and they came back. Imam Ali came back to Rasulullah, and he went to Mosque of Nabawi, and that was the clear defeat of Christians, clear defeat of Christianity. When Rasulullah reached Masjid Nabawi, Jibreel alayhi salam came with the salam of Allah. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying salam to you. And he said, if Christians continued to do Mubahila, they will face the same fate as faced by the Qarun, as is faced by Qarun, who was actually doing the Mubahila. With whom? With Musa and Harun and their Ahlul Bayt. So it's a sort of Mubahila. When they asked Qarun to bring, to give zakat, he said, no, I'm not going to give it. He said, no, you have to give it. He said, no, you want to take my money? He said, no, we don't want to take your money. We want zakat for Islam, for Allah. He said, no, if it is for Allah, Allah will bring azab. Allah will bring a chastisement over me. And then what happened? The earth engulfed him with his own wealth, with his own supporters and his family members, who were the supporters of him. And exactly, the same thing happened with the Haris bin Nu'man Fari. You must have heard this even in Ide Ghadir. That Haris bin Nu'man Fari, when he came to Rasulullah and asked that, why did you do it? Why did you impose Imam Ali as our Imam and Mawla over us? Is this your decision? If it is your decision, okay, I'm not going to accept it. If it is the decision of Allah, then Allah will bring some chastisement, azab over me. And before he rode upon his horse, a stone came from the sky and hit his head, and he died instantly. So what is Mubahila? You are asking God for the land, for the chastisement, for the azab. And always it happened whenever you ask for it, because you are challenging God. And when you are challenging God, God will never go to back foot. You will see him always in the forefront. Anyway, the Mubahila came to an end and everything was over, and the Christians of Najran did not accept Islam, except Abu Harisa. All of them, they went back. Regarding the ayah Mubahila, there are some objections, unfortunately, raised by some critics who are Muslims by themselves. So let us discuss these objections and their answers given by our ulama. But before that, loud salawat. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Let us discuss objections over the ayah Mubahila. There are three objections. The first objection is, can we apply the ayah of Mubahila over the Ahlul Bayt? The second objection is, there are words which used as plural, and the number of people were not in plural numbers. Okay. The third objection is, will the progeny, or is that possible the progeny of Rasulullah will continue with Fatima or with a lady? Let's discuss the first objection. About the application of this ayah over Ahlul Bayt, not only the Shia scholars, but even the Sunni scholars, they have admitted that this ayah totally and accurately can be applied over Ahlul Bayt. The first example is Ayatullah Qazi Shostri, who wrote in his book Ihfaul Haq, and he quoted 60 Sunni scholars that this ayah totally accurately applicable over Ahlul Bayt. I mean the addressee, people who are being addressed are actually Ahlul Bayt. Number one. Number two, there is a book we call Ghayatul Maram. In this book, there is a tradition which is quoted from Sahih Muslim, the second most authentic book of Ahl Sunnah. There is a tradition regarding Sa'ad bin Abi Waqas, a dialogue between Sa'ad bin Abi Waqas and Amir al-Sham. Amir al-Sham asked Sa'ad bin Abi Waqas, "Oh Sa'ad bin Abi Waqas, why don't you curse Imam Ali and his Ahlul Bayt?" Sa'ad bin Abi Waqas gave the answer, "When the ayah of Mubahila revealed, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought his family, that is Ali, Hassan, Hussein and Fatima to the field of Mubahila, and when they were sitting together, Rasulullah said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, haza ha'ulahi ahli, that these are my Ahlul Bayt, my households, my family members. That is why I think we should not curse those whose prestige cannot be challenged. Nobody can surpass their prestige. That's why I do not do it." Zamhashari, one of the greatest Sunni scholars, Zamhashari, mentioned in his tafsir, Tafsir-e-Kishaf, that this ayah is enough to endorse, to prove the glory or the prestige of Ahlul Bayt or the Ahli Kisah. And also, this is mentioned in our books that Imam Raza alayhi salam, in the court of Ma'mun, among the people who were not Shia, did the Manazira. And he quoted this ayah and he said that according to this ayah, Ahlul Bayt, that is Ali, Hassan, Fatima, Hussein and Rasulullah, they are the people whom we can apply this ayah, and these are the people nobody can have any equality, nobody can surpass their prestige. So this is the proof from our books and from others' books that this ayah totally accurately can be applicable can be applied to those who are Ahlul Bayt, that is Hassan, Ali, Fatima and Rasulullah. The second point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use plural words. That is, he used the word abna'ana, that is sons. He used the word nisa'ana, that is ladies or women. He used the word anfusana, that is nufus, or your substitute or your successor. And none of them were in plural number. Actually, in Arabic, we have singular, that is applied to one. We have dual, that is applied to two, tathniya. And we have plural, that is applied to three or more than three. When we say abna ana, it means sons, plural, that is three or more than sons. It is not applied to two, that is tathni, plural, three or more than two, more than three. There were only two sons present, Hassan and Hussein. So, my dear critic, you should have this point in your mind that Rasulullah at that point, at that time, had only two sons. The third one, the Muhsin, was martyred when the door of Bibi Sayyida was put into fire. Remember those, remember that tragedy if you do not remember, if you missed that point. Number two, in the verse Nisa'ana, that means your ladies, your women, our women and your women. So ladies, so Rasulullah had a lot of ladies. That means if we include the wife, there were more than three. So why only Fatima was there? That may be not the true misdaq of this ayah. So the answer is true. Rasulullah had so many ladies, so many women in his house as a wife, for example. But the lady who can fight with the Christians and whose witness can be accepted by Allah without any cringe or any weakness, this is the lady of Bibi Sayyida. This is the lady Bibi Sayyida who can fight with those who are on the wrong side. And Anfusana, Rasulullah, why did he not bring other companions? You should think about yourself that why did he not bring? Because none of them had the equality in fadila, in prestige, with Ali. Ali was the best in the eye of Allah, in the eye of Rasul. That is why he brought Ali. And from here it is proved that Ali is the successor. Ali is the true substitute of Rasulullah, as he mentioned in Ghadir Khum, Man kunta maulahu maulahu fahada Ali maula. Whomever I am the maula, I am the owner, Ali is the owner, Ali is the maula. So Ali was the true successor of Rasulullah as according to this ayah. And number two, remember, there are so many verses in the Quran in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the word of plural for singular person. For example, in one verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna Allaha faqirun nahnu aghniya. Actually, there was a person, his name was Hay bin Akhtab. He was a very rich person and he took huge amount of money from Abu Sufyan to impress people and to threat them that if you do not convert to kufr or you do not become kafir, I will kill you and I have a lot of money, I can do anything. So his name was Hay bin Akhtab, and he used to laugh over the Muslims because Muslims at that time were suffering from poverty, hardships. So he was laughing that your God is a poor God, my God is rich, your God is poor, and myself, I am a rich person. So he used to say, Inna Allah faqirun wa nahnu aghniya. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word nahnu, and he was saying ana aghniya. He did not say nahnu, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word nahnu. Nahnu means if it is more than one, the same ayah can be applied. But at that time there is only one person. This is mentioned in Surah Al Imran, verse number 183. Now let's come to another verse in which it is mentioned that it can be applied to many people. This is mentioned in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16 and verse number 120. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Ibrahim, how? As Ummah. He said, Ibrahim as Ummah. Inna Ibrahima kana ummatan. For sure, Ibrahim was a nation. He was not two, not three, not ten, not equal to one city. He was like a nation, a big group of people. Just like we say that this person is like an army. This person is equal to the whole team. He can beat the whole team alone. This warrior or soldier can beat the whole army. He is so powerful. So Ibrahim was here. The whole Ummah was there. Ibrahim was like Ummah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has used the word plural for those who are singular. So this is the answer of the question of the critic that they made, that why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the plural word here. The last objection which they did is what? How it is possible that the progeny of Rasulullah continued through the lady, through the woman, that is Bibi Sayyida? It is not that much unacceptable or surprising, because Allah is Allah. As we said that Allah can create Adam al-Islam without father, without mother. Allah can create Isa al-Islam without father. So Allah can continue the progeny of a person through his daughter, because this is his rule, this is his world, this is his creation. He can manage by himself. He may have any exception for anybody. This may be the rule for you and me, but for Rasulullah it is not the rule. So that is why we say that the progeny of Rasulullah continued through Lady Fatima. How? It's very simple. This is mentioned also in Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran, وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِهِ دَاوُدَ وَسُلَيْمَانَ وَأَيُّوبَ وَيُوسُفَ وَحَارُونَ وَمُوسَى وَحَارُونَ كُلُّ نَجْزِ الْمُحْسِنِينَ كَذَلِكَ نَجْزِ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And then he continued, وَزَكَرِيَّ وَيَحْيَى وَعِيسَى وَإِلْيَاسَ كُلُّ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. So see, he mentioned all of them with their father, and their father was responsible for their progeny. But Isa al-Islam did not have father. So why did he put Isa al-Islam among those who had their father? Isa al-Islam was there because of his mother, Bibi Maryam. So all of them continued their progeny through father, and only Isa continued his progeny through the mother. So if Isa al-Islam can belong to the progeny of Daud through his mother, through the lady, through the woman, Bibi Maryam, then why not Sayyid or Sadat or Imam or Ahlul Bayt can be the progeny of Rasulullah through Bibi Sayyida? This is what we have seen in the Quran also, verse number 83 and 84. This is in the Quran, surah, I forgot the surah, but this is the 83 and 84 ayah. Anyway, so this is the objection. Now let's come to another point in which another phase in which we will discuss that what are the other events which were there. It was Surah An'am, chapter 6, verse 84 and 85. That is, we talk about Isa al-Islam belong to the progeny of Daud al-Islam. Anyway, let's come to the fourth stage of our debate, that is all about other events which took place beside Mubahila. Ayat Tathir, chapter 33, verse 33. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this ayah on the same day, 24th of Zilhijj. إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيَزْهَبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to keep the Nijasa, to repel Nijasa away from Ahlul Bayt and purify them as thoroughly purified. Number two, this is the ayah which Rasulullah quoted and gave the reference when he was in Mubahila. And this was the ayah which was revealed when the event of Hadith al-Qisa took place. Hadith al-Qisa, which usually we recite in our majalis or before any event which we celebrate in our homes or in our Imam Barga. So this is Hadith al-Qisa. The event of Hadith al-Qisa took place on 24th of Zilhijj, the same day. Number two, Ayat-e-Vilayat. What is Ayat-e-Vilayat or Ayat-e-Vilayah? Ayat-e-Vilayah is about the Vilayah of Ali. This is mentioned in Surah Maidah, chapter 5, verse number 55. إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ وَرُسُلُهُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَهُمْ رَاكِعُونَ. That the wali of people is Allah, Rasul, and those who pray namaz and give zakat during ruku. And this is mentioned in the books of history that once Imam Ali was praying and some destitute came into the Mosque of Nabawi and asked the people to give something, but nobody gave him anything. So Imam Ali stretched out his hand during the ruku and he took out his finger. When the people objected over the concentration or over the validity of namaz of Ali, that he was not well focused in namaz, he was listening to the destitute, he was engaged in giving alms, zakat. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this ayah that this action of Ali does not break his namaz, did not create any naqs or defect in the namaz. Despite this is one of the sign of his vilayah. Number two. Number three, Surah Dahar or Surah Insan or Surah Al-Ata. These are the three names of the same surah. Chapter number 76 and especially the verse 8. وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ. Who feed the people food just for the love of Allah. Who? يَتِيمًا وَمَسْكِينًا وَأَسِيرًا. Yatim, miskin, and asir. Destitute, traveler, and the prisoner. And this happened once Ahlul Bayt fasted for 3 days, and the 3 days, every day there was a person asking for the food. Once on the first day there was yatim, the second day was miskin, then second day yatim, and the third day was asir. So this verse and especially this surah was revealed to Ahlul Bayt in the prestigiousness of the Ahlul Bayt. So Rasulullah asked first of all another companion to take this surah and teach people. When he was on his way, Rasulullah, the wahi came to Rasulullah and asked Rasulullah, no, this person does not deserve to teach and preach this surah. You should send Ali. So Ali went after him and he took the surah and he taught the surah to the people. So these three events along with Mubayra took place on the same day, that is 24th of Zilhijja. It is quite similar to Eid-e Ghadir, you know. Three other events also took place in the Eid of Ghadir. Now, on 18th of Zilhijja, the last phase of our debate, our speech, our dars is about Amal. Remember, we are the people that we should have a self-control all the time, and especially when we are happy, when we are celebrating some ceremony and we are exalted in some jubilation and we are very much happy, because it is an experience of the people that usually you slip away from your track when you are happy. You can see in the Western countries what they do in their Christmas day, what they do in New Year Eve. So whenever there is a day of happiness, like birthday for example, or sometimes it happens unfortunately among us, among our community, that is Muslims community, in the marriage parties, in birthday parties, usually we have music, usually we have mixed gathering. Not all of the people they do it, but some of the people they do it. So when you ask them and you ask them to stop it, they say no, in happiness, in prayer you are allowed to do it. This is wrong. So remember, whenever you have a good day, good thing, good event to celebrate, your responsibilities become more. That is why we have two surah, two rakat namaz of Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha, and both the surah contain the same sentence more or less, that is the message is same. Qad aflaha man zakka, surah Shams, first rakat of Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha, and qad aflaha man tazakka. Second rakat of Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. Both of them have the same ma'ana. That is, the main success is to purify your nafs. So that is very much important from Allah. Important point to remember, that we should not go away from our track. And our responsibility regarding the obedience of Allah, worship of Allah becomes more. How? In the Ghadir you have different amals. Similarly, we have amals in Eid-e Mubahila. And they are quite similar to Eid-e Ghadir. That's why quite easy to remember. First of all, what we say, that you should rejoice, you should show your happiness, you should feel the pleasure, you should feel it internally and you should show it to the people. What I believe, that we should celebrate Eid-e Ghadir and Eid al-Mubahila in such a way that the people will join us. Like 9th and 10th Muharram, we do lament, we do matam, we do aza, we do griya, we cry, we weep. And we are so much out of our sense that people become sad. When they look at us, they become sad. And the government of Pakistan gave 2 days vacation, 9th and 10th. Shia have to do something with the Karbala and with the 9th and 10th Muharram. They are commemorating the Aza. What about other people? But their Aza has got so much intensity that the whole city, the whole country is engulfed by this Aza. And you think that all the people have converted to Shia and all the whole country is the follower of Mazhab of Ahlul Bayt. So why don't we celebrate Eid-e Ghadir and Eid al-Mubahila in such a way that people will give the government, the people will join us and the government will give us 2 extra vacation holidays. And it is not that much difficult. In New York they have proved. In New York school nowadays they are going to give 2 days extra holidays, because these 2 days belong to the Eids of Muslims, Eid al-Fitr, Eid al-Adha. Because children are absent from their schools, Muslims are absent from their offices. So they say that if they are absent continuously in this way, so it is better to give official holiday from the school at least. So why don't we celebrate Eid al-Adhir and Eid al-Mubahila, that government will be bound to give holidays on this occasion. Number 2, ghusl, we should do. Number 3, you should give sadaqah. This is the same, actually rejoice, give sadaqah or do ghusl, it is same like Eid al-Adhir. Then number 4, fast. Fasting of Eid al-Adhir is important, fasting of Mubahila is also mustahab. Then number 5, you should pray namaz, 2 rakat namaz, exactly the same what you have done in Eid al-Adhir. In the first rakat and the second rakat, in both the rakat, you have to recite 10 times Surah Ikhlas, Ayatul Kursi, and Surya Padra, 10 times each in both raga. Then three amal is something different from either Ghadir. That is, you have to recite a special dua of Mubaila, which you can find in Mufati or duas.org if you go to the website. Ziyarat Jame Kabira and Ziyarat Jame Sarira. So these are the amal which you have to carry out, and this is the way you should celebrate your Eid Mubaila and Eid Ghadir. And I hope that you would have understood the message of Eid Mubaila. And we pray to Allah that Allah give us opportunity to celebrate these Eid the way they deserve. These Eid deserve to be celebrated. And we pray to Allah that Allah give us opportunity to follow the messages, to act upon the messages given by Mubaila. It is just not an event, it is a chapter, it is a book in which we can find pearls of wisdoms and so many points to understand our lifestyle. So we pray to Allah that He will hasten the zahur of Imam Ali, Imam Mahdi, and He will join us as His soldier and His helpers. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
اللجن يا صاحب السماء.